Good day, Lionel. I want to talk to you about something deep.
Okay, let's have it.
Do you think we have free will, or are we the products of biological and environmental determinism?
Actually, I've given this a lot of thought. But why do you ask?
I've been accused of doing something stupid, but I want to establish that I could have done nothing else, that I was merely responding to the forces that push me one way or another. You know, the forces of determinism.
That is pretty heavy. But you should be doing more than using philosophical questions to escape personal responsibility.
Well, I still need to know whether I'm right or not.
That's a troubling point here. Free will and determinism are ways of explaining what we experience. We can't establish a single correct answer.
How can that be? We either have one or the other, right?
Well, technically, we can have free will while still having the forces of determinism, but that's getting ahead of ourselves.
What do you mean? Are you saying I might both be responsible for my foolish act and also not responsible?
Now you bring up another conundrum. We would have to define the term responsible, because it is your response, and you will experience any consequences of that response, but I think you mean it in a deeper form, one that rests on a notion of free will.
Okay. Please explain.
The idea of free will rests on the notion that humans are actors in their lives, rather than responders to forces that trigger particular behaviors.
Do you mean actors, like in, goofy cartoons on the internet?
Actually, no. Really quite the reverse. But that was funny. Really, it means actors rather than responders. In determinism, there are essentially three types of forces that make humans behave in the ways that they do. These are 1. Biology, 2. One's history of experiences, and 3. The current situation.
Can you take each one in turn?
Sure. First, biology. We can start with our DNA. The genetic structure that comes together when we are conceived will create certain physical characteristics, and most theorists agree that some of our personality, or at least temperament, are formed at that time as well. So, if it is written into our genetic codes, then we would be compelled to react in programmed ways to the environment.
Can you give me an example?
Sure. Let's assume someone inherits the genes for alcoholism. Then alcohol will process differently in his or her body than in the body of someone without these genes. While anyone can become an alcoholic with enough effort, the person with the genes is essentially pre-programmed to compulsively pursue and consume alcohol.
But no one puts a gun to their heads and forces them to drink.
No one has to. It is a compulsion that overwhelms their rational thinking. Sort of like when you have a mosquito bite and find yourself compelled to scratch the itch.
This is a lot. We should sit down. Here's a bench.
Good idea.
So that's a little about DNA. What other biological forces?
There are things like hunger and thirst, heat, need for sleep, and other biological drives. We can see how eating salt increases the need to drink, and we are manipulated when sellers know this and use it against our better intentions. The brain is wired to pay attention to certain survival opportunities. We will always be drawn to eating high-calorie foods because they were rare and hard to come by in our natural environment. But now, we can eat lots of them all day, every day. The brain is wired to pursue them, even though they are now so plentiful that we damage our health through overconsumption.
Wow. How about the history of experiences?
Well, everything that has ever happened to you, whether you consciously remember it or not, contributes to what you do. If your early experiences of a certain food, say carrots, were predominantly terrible and bad tasting, then you'll likely avoid carrots and avoid foods with carrots in them, or that trigger a sense of carrots. However, if you had lentil dishes that were always yummy, then you'll be conditioned to be drawn to lentil dishes after that. You may always be prone to find carrots and lentils triggering certain responses in you.
That sounds like classical conditioning. Like Pavlov and the dog that would slobber when it heard a bell, just because the bell was rung just before the dog received food.
Yes, that's one way that our experiences can undermine our conscious thought. Sometimes, the way events from our history affect us are obvious, and we can trace them back to their origins. More often, not. We just respond without knowing why, or even by thinking that we are in full control of our preferences and selections and behavior.
And how about the third factor? About the current situation?
That's easier. Just think, if it started raining right now, what would you do?
Duh, I'd go inside one of these buildings to get out of the rain.
You think you just decide to do that, but you've been trained and conditioned. How many times have you heard, any fool knows enough to come in out of the rain? But that's really part of history of experiences. You see, the weather condition is part of the current situation, and it will affect your mood, where your attention is focused, and so on. You select your clothes because of the temperature today, just like I pick mine, because it is the appropriate clothing for my job. We sat on the bench when we were tired of standing. If you were hungry or late for an appointment, then you would have a hard time paying attention and would not have asked me to explain. You see, the current situation builds upon the biology and the history of experiences.
So, are you saying that I really couldn't help it? That I did a stupid, silly thing because it was bound to happen and I had no control over it? I'm off the hook.
Not at all. I was just giving you an explanation of that side of the question, determinism. But we haven't addressed free will yet.
I was afraid there was more to it.
Free will is the idea that we have a capacity to transcend the forces of determinism. It doesn't deny that those forces are present and have a profound impact, it just declares that humans have the ability to go beyond them. We have a fourth causal factor to our actions, and that is our own self-initiated free will.
Well, do we?
No one can prove it one way or the other. As I said early on, determinism and free will are ways to explain and understand what we see in the world. Most people believe in free will. Both of the world's most populous religions, Christianity and Islam, rely on a foundation of free will. They couldn't exist without that assumption. Of course, the determinists would argue that they can't help but believe that way.
So, am I right or wrong? Do I have to take the blame, or am I off the hook?
I can't really tell you that. Sorry, that's the frustrating thing.